Hello, everyone, and welcome to Tilden's Open House. We're just going to wait about one or two more minutes for people to join us, and then we'll get started. Just a reminder to put your mic on mute if you're not speaking. We will have plenty of time at the end for questions and answers. And I encourage people also, as we go through the presentation, if you have questions that come up, please put them in the chat box because we will be fielding that throughout the presentation. So again, welcome. We'll just give it another minute or two for people to join. I should introduce myself. I am Rebecca Hawley. I'm the Director of Special Education and Admissions. And give us 1 second and we will start. Hey, Lori, should we go ahead and get started?
Yeah, sounds great. Thank you so much, Rebecca. Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out here onto Zoom this evening with us. It's really nice to see a small group. It actually makes meeting together and just kind of getting a sense of our program and talking about any questions that you have a lot easier. My name is Lori Kumar. I am the director at Tilden Preparatory School. We have two campuses, one in Albany, very close to Berkeley, and one in downtown Walnut Creek. And I'd like to just talk a little bit about Tilden, our model, who are our students, and a little bit about what we do. Tilden was founded in 2006 by two family psychologist, Dr. Karen Hobbs and Dr. Sherry Noonan. They have met with a lot of students and they were really looking to found a school where students can really find their niche. They can find where they belong. They can find their unique learning style and a place to kind of, that balances this kind of gray area between the therapeutic and an academic environment, while at the same time providing a rigorous academic environment for students to thrive and to meet their academic goals. So we were founded in 2006. We are a middle school and high school. We service students from sixth grade to 12th grade and sometimes beyond. You know, there's some students we have who we tutor in college. And, you know, at Tilden, we believe that no student, no size fits all. You know, every student is so unique. Their needs are so unique. Where their background, where they came from, what they need to succeed is unique from every other student. And I think that's what makes Tilden an incredibly special school for all students. And for us as educators, just a delightful treat. You know, it's, if you can ask any teacher or administrator what they enjoy most about Tilden, and it's really working with the students. And what I have been so impressed with in my 10 years at Tilden is seeing that every single student has a turnaround story. Sometimes that happens their first day at Tilden, where they go home and tell their parents, "Oh my gosh, you know, this is amazing. I made some friends and was really able to connect with the teacher." Sometimes it's at the end of the week. Sometimes it's one semester in, 1 year in, but it's really amazing to see every student get what they need and see themselves in a different light, see that they can be successful. We're going to be talking a little bit about our intake process and meeting with Dr. Hawley, our Director of Admissions and Special Education. But part of that intake is talking about, you know, where is the student at? What do they need when they come to Tilden? How can we best support? And talking about academic goals, and it's really rewarding at the end of semester to check in again and say, have we hit it? You know, where are we at? How can we help from here? And I think all of us are kind of smiling, you know, as we're talking about this, because students come to us and, you know, it's amazing that they'll come and say, you know, I want to take a more challenging class. If they're in geometry, they might say, can I take honors geometry, you know? And it's just so incredible and so rewarding for us to see students advocate for themselves, which is out of this world. It's amazing to see our students, you know, feel comfortable coming to us as educators, to their teachers. And it's amazing for us to see their motivation and confidence increase in themselves. So it's a really, really special place. A little bit about our model. We are a very small school, and we are definitely a traditional program. It is a real school where we have UC approved courses. We're WASC accredited. And what makes us unique is how we teach each student, which is one-to-one. And we use a mastery learning model, which I think a lot of parents are curious about, you know, what exactly is that? And at the heart of a mastery learning model is really focusing on student retention. We want students to really learn the material. And so what that looks like is we work with students at their own pace, wherever they're at, and we help them to reach at least an 80% mastery level. And so if a student goes through a unit and they take an assessment and it's below 80%, what we do is we take that as a learning opportunity, and we sit down with them. We do an analysis of how they did on the exam. We talk about some areas where we could continue to support them so they can understand the material better. And then we have them retest and see where they're at. And it's a pretty cool experience for students. Because there's that 80% mastery level, so that most students do very, very well when they're at Tilden, but it's a really interesting learning experience for them because they're really taking a lead with their teacher, who is kind of a teacher mentor, to learn the material and to learn it in a sustainable way. I think another part that I want to highlight about our model is, you know, with the one-to-one, our main focus is on the relationship. So it starts with our relationship with you today, and it also starts with our relationship with you during the intake. And we continue that relationship and that partnership really in your student success. So, you know, part of that intake again is really getting to know that student. And when that student works with teachers, it's really developing a trust. So that's what the first couple days are, is developing a trust where the students and the teachers can work together and they can move through the material in a way that students have never worked with teachers before. And so it's really a true partnership. We want to hear from you at any point in time, you know, with any questions you have. We also have a wealth of resources. So even if you walk away today saying, you know, right now it's not really the best fit, we have an amazing staff. Dr. Rebecca Holly is here as our director of admissions and special education, and she has so many connections within the community to help support with therapy, other types of placement that might be a better fit. We have our associate head of school from Walnut Creek here, Malcolm Govinder, who is amazing as well. And we just want to see students thrive. And I think this year more than ever, it's been an incredibly difficult year for students and for families and for, you know, everyone in education. And so for us, our biggest priority is being there for you. And we do that in a lot of ways. I mean, of course, you know, through our program, but I bet Dr. Rebecca Holly is going to talk about her parent support group, which is free to the community, and our parent speaker series. So I just want to encourage all of you to take advantage of that. The last thing I want to talk about is who is our Tilden student? And I think this is where we get a lot of parents who call and say, oh, you know, I'm not sure if this is going to be the best fit because I heard Tilden services these kids or those kids. And, you know, and the reality is we service all students, because it's one-to-one, we really do meet the student where they're at. And we have such a broad student population. We have students that are neurotypical and they just want a different instructional style. They want the one-to-one, the smaller class model, and that really works for them. We have students who are in transition. They might be transitioning out of a treatment program or a residential program or therapeutic program and need some additional support, which we can provide. We also have students who are coming to us filling in gaps. So they might actually have a school of record and come to us to take a class or two just to fill in some gaps that are missing, especially this year with learning loss. We've got a lot of students taking classes with us just to either better understand the material that was covered the last year and a half, or to take a class where they feel that they can be held while they're learning material that might be challenging due to learning loss. We do have a lot of students with learning differences, which Rebecca Holly is our expert and helps families and students and teachers navigate learning differences. And we also have students that are advanced, accelerated, exceptionally gifted, and need to work at a pace that is challenging for them and interesting for them, just so they can continue to stay interested in the material. And that's just to name a few. And I think, what I've always found very interesting about our community is that we value our community building. We value the social relationships that we have on campus. We value inclusivity. And I think it's really neat from my perspective to see our students value that as well. So our students really connect with each other. They welcome new students to campus, and it doesn't matter, your history, what grade you're in, what your neurotypical, atypical status is. They really, really connect with each other, and it's just a really precious thing that we have going. So I'm going to go ahead and pass this off to Rebecca Holly, but if you have any questions and you're thinking about them now, feel free to put them in the chat box and we'll start answering them shortly.
Thanks, Lori. Hi, everybody. So I'll just start. I always like to just share how I learned about Tilden first as a parent when my daughter was transitioning from 8th to 9th grade, and she was in a public charter school, arts-based school in the East Bay. And it really wasn't going well in terms of the math and science. My daughter was diagnosed with pretty severe dyslexia and auditory processing disorder when she was 6. So kind of have been through this whole journey. She's now 21, college aged. And she was really just failing math and science in her kind of homeschool, and a lot of school refusal, a lot of what I call kind of situational anxiety, not getting out of the car, wanting to come home, just around certain classes at school, where she was really struggling with the learning differences and not having teachers really being able to get what she needed or what she was trying to advocate for building those skills. So happening, I happen to be in the field, and I've been in this field for 20 plus years in child development, youth development, and special education, and started to do research on my own and found Tilden. So throughout high school, my daughter took part in Tilden in a hybrid model. And that really worked for her, and just seeing it and going through the process as a parent. And for my daughter, seeing that aha moment that no, she would never be a mathematician or scientist. She's a professional artist now, but she passed the courses and she got a B minus, which for her was her A plus. And that was pretty spectacular. She felt like she could do it. She could graduate high school. She could kind of pursue what she wanted to in the arts conservatory path. And her self-esteem just went way up around, I have another way that I can do this. So kind of knowing this on a philosophical kind of educational level, but living it as a parent of, excuse my language, what do I do? I'm stuck here. I found Tilden. And coincidentally, as my daughter was actually a junior in high school, there was an opening and I happened to be in the position transferring from Stanford at that point for family reasons, commute, et cetera. It was like, that's where I want to be. So I've been here ever since. I was the former head of school at Walnut Creek and have been in this position as special education director for a year plus now. One of my roles is really to support families now as we get to learn more about Tilden from the team via the intake process to really learn about your family, your student, your goals for your student's goals, maybe if they don't even realize it right now, and really get a sense of what is needed for that student on the transition in. From the special education side, and I really view special education, and I often refer to it not as learning disabilities, but learning differences, encompasses a lot. It really just means that some traditional models of private and public school don't work for all students that maybe think outside the box, need a different approach, absolutely can do it, but need to do it in a way that works for them, or maybe are coming with a lot of dings of feeling not smart or not successful and having a self-image of their self as not, quote, the best learner in judgment to what the traditional model often models as this is what is expected. So I really gather that story and help with that transition of where a student is at, what that transition looks like into Tilden, be it full-time or part-time. And for every student, even if it's a hybrid model with a home school of record or Tilden as their school of record, putting accommodations in place that really work for that individual student. If a student is coming in that has a 504 or an IEP, we look at that as a team, and with my guidance, we really discuss kind of what was working with that, what wasn't. Usually we go above and beyond just because of our model, but we like to kind of historically know what has happened in that child's both social emotional development and academic development. If a student's coming in and they just have a neuropsych or evaluations from doctors and parents feel that that's important for us to know about, we'll review that too as a team. And then with my guidance, working with the heads of school, we really think intentionally about who that teaching team should be for that student in terms of getting that student's learning style, the accommodations, and not just the accommodations, but the approach that's needed. And through that process, we work really closely in collaboration with the family, with the student, with the teachers and any other service provider that a family and student happens to be working with and wants us to collaborate with. So essentially that's somewhat my role. I do a lot of the teacher training as well around neurodiversity and approaches to teaching and learning and just campus community. And as Lori said, I facilitate a parent support group often with guest speakers, which is really a peer-to-peer facilitated group with my support. To talk about the trials and tribulations of raising students with neuro differences. That can be twice exceptionality to severe learning differences to mental health challenges that may manifest sometimes like learning differences and get in the way in terms of accessing education, school participation, social life, et cetera. So that's my role within the program. I also support families with applying for accommodations for standardized testing like the PSAT, SAT, and ACT and AP testing. And then also have the conversations of what do accommodations look like as you transition to adult age and college, if that's the plan for either 2 year or 4 year. So thank you for giving me time to speak.
Thank you so much, Rebecca. I know that Rebecca just shared the conversations in education here in the download folder, so you can just go ahead and take a look at that in the chat. And I just like to invite anyone to ask any questions you might have. You can write it in the chat, or if you want to, we're probably a small enough group, so if you wanted to just ask your question, that would be fine as well.
Hi, I'm wondering about the hybrid system. Can you just walk through what logistically how that works or what a student's life is like when they're doing that? And what are some of the examples of why students do that?
Mm-hmm. That's actually a great question. So students, we have two categories of students. One is our full-time students who are here at Tilden and we're their school of record. And then we also have our part-time students, or we sometimes refer to them as attending Tilden as a hybrid. And so we have a lot of students in the surrounding schools that might take a class or two with us. And the reason they do that, I mean, sometimes it's just to retake a class that they would rather take as one-to-one because they didn't do as well the first time around. Sometimes they just want to take a class with us. There's maybe a subject that they find very challenging and want to take it at Tilden where they're going to get the support that they need. So that's also an option. And we also have such a wide range of courses, our language courses. I can try to rattle off how many of our language courses that come to mind, but we have everything from French to German to Mandarin, American Sign Language. So we've got just such a breadth of courses that students find it beneficial to take with us if they really wanted to go in that direction. And then also our AP courses. We have, again, just a breadth of AP courses. And AP courses can be particularly challenging for students in a traditional school when they have to pace at the same pace as the rest of the students in their classroom. So oftentimes families choose Tilden so that we can help a student through their AP course, go at their pace, and they often do really, really well. Our students, I haven't looked at the averages from the last year, but they usually average in the 4 and 5 score range. So it's just a wonderful opportunity for students. I hope that answers your question.
Well, one thing is, so if you're not taking an AP at the school and you're taking it at Tilden, do you physically leave your school? I mean, you're not also your school, right? Your days aren't really, really long.
Yeah, so we have, thanks to COVID, we've actually really developed our remote instruction model. So, students can decide to come to campus if they wanted to and have in-person instruction, or they can choose remote instruction. So it's completely up to them. A lot of our part-time students pre-COVID, when they had to come in person, would come after 2:45 or so. But now, depending on the block schedules and, talking with the school counselor, some students are actually just going to the library or finding some place on campus where they can just log in and have their hour class with their teacher at Tilden.
Instead of doing that math class at their own school.
Correct, yeah. Okay, and that's something that they can usually, you just start that conversation with the school counselor.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I'm seeing a couple questions here that I'll just go ahead and start answering. So Mark asked, how does tuition work and what is the overall cost per year in general? Would you like to answer that one, Rebecca?
Sure. It's so individualized depending on if you're taking a few classes or a full load of classes, what year it is, if it's AP, honors, regular. So it's so individualized that what we would actually recommend, and I will put my email in there, is to have an initial conversation one-on-one so we can really get a sense of where your student's at, what grade they're in, if you're thinking of part-time, if you're thinking of full-time. And then we can break down the courses and how that works and give you a really customized tuition estimate based on your specific situation. It's so individualized that it really varies family by family, including are you taking the bare minimum just for middle school, for high school graduation, AP track. So Mark, if you'd like to have that conversation, we can definitely set something up this week. And anyone else that would like to, I'll put my email in there and we can find time to really discuss the individual needs of your family and your student.
Thank you, Rebecca. So Malcolm, actually, this might be a good question for you. Here's a question from Angela where she says, can you speak about campus community or the social aspect of Tilden?
Yeah, you know, first of all, it's so great to see students again. You know, we're loving this, having them on campus. And, you know, just the energy they bring, it's just amazing. So we've been having our lunches across the street. So we're not eating on campus. So we, as a group, go across the street every day to Sixth Grade Park. And all students are meeting there and having lunch together. And it's great to see that, you know, pre-COVID, they spent a lot more time on their phones, but there's a lot more socializing now. So that's wonderful to see. We've started a lot of clubs on campus as well. We've got a leadership club, a chess club, of course, the gaming club. That's a no-brainer, right? There, we've got a robotics and maker club as well. And we've got a music club. So these give students opportunities to connect, share interests. And then we have students that work at different levels. We have some students that compete in robotics as well. And, you know, they're really happy to share their knowledge, you know, and skills as well. So it's wonderful community for that. We've got a survival skills class for students that are more interested in the outdoors. We've got some admin leading that. So we're always trying to create more opportunities. And some of these clubs are student-driven. If a few students get together, you know, we will find a teacher or admin to support them. And we have group classes, especially like some of our art classes are group classes. We've got digital photography. So great opportunities for collaboration and, you know, creativity over there. And, you know, it's a wonderful community. And I really, you know, please stop by. We'd love to give you a tour and have you meet our students and see what we do over here. It's very welcoming. And, you know, you really get a sense that, you know, we're all kind of in it together when you come to the campus. Thank you.
Thank you, Malcolm. And I just want to also add that, you know, the time, you know, what Malcolm's talking about, those clubs, they're so intentional. And a big part of, you know, our model is supporting social emotional learning on campus for a lot of our students and giving them some structured facilitated time. So those lunch clubs, we have a lunch club on both campuses every single lunch. And as Malcolm described, they're a lot of them are student driven and facilitated time where, you know, students of all ages, even teachers, come and spend their lunchtime with the students and really have a great time. The group classes are excellent. And, you know, this year, it's so important, probably more important than any other year, for us to be building mm-hmm. our community back. And that's a conversation we're having every day amongst ourselves on each of the campuses and then as a leadership team. It's so important for the kids to get reintegrated with their social groups. And it's really fun to see them, you know, run off campus, go grab a boba drink or whatever they do, and then come back on campus and have those friendships. You know, this weekend we were at the Solano Stroll, and, you know, it was as much as kind of connecting with the community as it was also for us connecting our students with each other. So it's a really big part of what we do. And we're also planning our first annual Tilden family picnic, which is going to be so awesome. I can't tell you, Rebecca, how excited I am about that one. And we're also talking about, we've done this before, but just more intentionally, having weekend adventures with students where we might go fishing or we might go bowling and just really help students connect and have a more traditional school experience.
Just to add to that, I've been at the Albany campus quite a bit the last month plus. I usually go in between, just a little more support to the Albany campus. And kids have an idea of doing a rock climbing expedition because there's a new facility opening up down the street on Solano. So we talked about that. That you didn't know. So now you know. So we talked about that today. And again, opening it up kind of cross campus. Another thing that a few kids at the Albany campus really want to do is a fashion show and including their pets. We'll see how this works out. So a lot of this is student driven, of kids really feeling comfortable to come in and say, this is what we're interested in, this is what we'd like to do, can you help us organize this? So as to rock climbing, which is for some kids indoors, to fashion show for pets, you can see the spectrum here. but it really is neat to see the community come back together. And, you know, clearly we're still very aware that we're still in a post-COVID and COVID climate, that we're doing this in a really safe way and making sure that everyone's protected in doing so. But we can always speak more at the intake to the social opportunities, which is a really big part of, as Laurie said, that social emotional development. And for anyone that has middle school age students, we also have really specific events where it's just the middle school age cohort, knowing that that's a whole different age in itself and different needs as well.
Thank you, Rebecca. Joni, you had a really good question. How many students do you accept each year or per grade, and how does that work? So, you know, we're open to accepting students as long as we have space, and we definitely have space. The only cohort that has a cap is our middle school cohort for each campus, and that's capped at about 10 to 15, depending on the campus and depending on the student cohort. And the reason we do that is we really want our middle schoolers to get the supervision and support that they need when they're on campus. So we do cap it. But as far as accepting students, you know, we start at the intake and make sure that it's a mutually good fit for both the campus and for the student. So that's probably where we would want to start. Angela, you asked, thinking of science, are there lab classes on offer too? And I want to say, yes, there are. We have labs. And right now, as Rebecca pointed out, there's a lot of transitioning that we're doing due to COVID. So our labs on both campuses are currently still closed. And we're going to be opening them up in January. That's the hope. Science teachers are very eager. I've had a couple conversations about it with them. Right now, we're using Labster, which is a virtual lab software, you know, program application. and many of our teachers are actually saying it's working really well. They're really enjoying it, and they're actually able to do certain labs that it's harder to do in person. So that's interesting. But our hope is to open up our labs. It's really fun for kids to get that hands-on experience, and we're really eager to do that this year. Lori asks, what are the qualifications for your teachers, teachers' assistants, and other staff? You want to talk about this one, Rebecca?
Sure. Yeah, at minimum, our teachers need to come in with a BA in the areas or multiple areas that they're teaching. We have also teachers that have master's, teaching credentials, PhDs. Because we're a private school, we don't require that teachers have a single subject or multi-subject credential. Some do because they've taught in the past in public school districts and really felt private or the one-on-one small group model is the way to go for them in terms of their teaching preference and the community of learners they want to be in. The one thing that we look for across the board, despite the teachers coming with a credential, BA, master's, or PhD, is that they really have the experience connecting with both middle school kids and high school kids that are coming with very diverse learning differences. So that teacher can welcome any student that comes in that maybe has a severe learning difference to extremely accelerated. So that's something that we look for in terms of not just the teaching modality, but the mentorship that that teacher provides as well.
Thank you, Rebecca. Linda is asking, does West Contra Costa accept credits from Tilden Prep? Our school counselor does not know of any students at our high school, De Anza, who have done this hybrid model. And what I would like to say is usually if you are interested in the hybrid model or another term for it would be concurrent enrollment. The conversation is best to start with the school counselor. We have worked with many of the districts, and sometimes it's a conversation that, you know, might wrap in the IEP or 504. It's a more complex conversation that we might have with you if you wanted us to be involved, or with the school counselor. So I would start with the school counselor. I know for sure we have worked with a couple students from De Anza, but it's really a conversation that I think we can start together, or again, you know, just go ahead and talk with the school counselor. And, you know, I have to say districts, especially right now, have become much more flexible around concurrent enrollment. Piedmont, correct me if I'm wrong, Rebecca, I think Piedmont is allowing 2 or 3 courses.
Piedmont's allowing 1 to 2, and that was passed by the board last year. San Ramon Valley is allowing 3. Oakland and Berkeley, it really varies. If you're a parent that has a student that has an IEP or 504, it can be a little bit of a different situation. So again, my email's in there if you just want to have a conversation about that approach to speaking with the counselor, if it's around a learning difference and concurrent enrollment, you know, please email me and we can set up a time.
Emily, do you have students start in a hybrid model and then move to full-time or vice versa? Yes, we do. That happens all the time. We have students, even now, you know, if your student is struggling, don't feel like they have to wait until the end of the semester in order to make a switch if they wanted to, for either one course or to their full course load. And what that looks like is when a student is transferring to Tilden, we'll sit down and do the usual intake, and we might ask for a copy of their grades from the learning management software. So that could be School Loop, Blackboard, PowerSchool. And what we like to do is to be able to capture the credit that the student has already worked for, and we can pick up the class wherever they left off. And we do have students, many students who might be with us full time and then just feel like, you know, I'm doing great. I want to go back to my normal program and have a more traditional experience. And they do that. And sometimes they do, and they're great, and they, you know, they thrive. And sometimes they go back and they realize, you know, I really enjoyed Tilden, and they come back. So we want to be as flexible as possible with whatever your student chooses is right for them. And we try to be as flexible as we can on our end, and keep you informed in terms of, you know, what to expect during that transition, either to Tilden or to, you know, another high school. So it really just depends, and we're happy to talk about it.
And I see that Emily had another kind of two-part question around, what if a student is unable to gain 80%? I will speak to this from a parent and from a children's faculty member, staff member. That sometimes isn't attainable for some students. And as I said, that 70% really may be that student's A or A plus. That's a conversation that then parents would have with the heads of school and or myself to say, like, this really is that student's mastery. And if parents are comfortable with moving on to the next material, moving forward, then we move on. That was the case for my daughter. She averaged out as a B minus for many of the courses that she took in math and science, and that really was her A. But there were many times where she didn't reach 80%. But I knew, you know, in my gut and how my kid learned, that 70% really is her A, and it's time to kind of move on. And we see that all the time with students, and that's a conversation that we have. We don't want that 80% to be a stressor or a trigger for students. It's a goal, but we also really look at the individual learning style around that student may be able to master that 80% in English and the humanities, but that 70% is their 95% in math and science. So again, it's really individual, and it's a conversation that we have with you.
Yeah, that's great, Rebecca. Shelley, can you start at any time? Is there a wait list, or what is the time from application to beginning beginning school typically? Well, yeah, you can start anytime. And I was describing that process a little bit. There usually isn't a wait list. It really depends on where we're at and if, you know, there's a lot of students enrolling at the same time, there might be a little bit more of a wait time. Usually from start to finish, from application to starting school, it might be probably about a week is what we're doing at this point. And, you know, we really want to, you know, I think you can tell, we really want to be very intentional about the whole process for the student, for the teacher, so that, you know, student really feels like they're held from day one and that they can be successful from day one. So we take the time that we need in order to make sure that that happens. That's all I see in the chat box. Are there any other questions that anyone would like to just chime in and ask or put anything in the chat box?
And as people are thinking about their questions, I also put just some upcoming events that we have in our Conversation of Education series, which when we have guest presenters from the community who we have a lot of community partnership with, come and speak to certain topics that really resonate within our Tilden community and within the community really at large around middle and high school needs right now. So you can kind of get a sense of who the speakers are coming up. Don't push on that little button there. It's not a live link. It's a decoy. It looks like it is. But if you want information on it, you can email me and I'll make sure that you're added to the list, so you have that registration link as we move forward with each event. I also put the course listing on there just so people can kind of get a sense of what we offer.
Great, thank you so much, Rebecca. I'm just thinking, are there any other questions that maybe we didn't talk about yet that come up during intake?
Is there, is there a music program?
Oh, that's a really good question. So we don't have, let me think here for a sec. We don't have necessarily like an orchestra or something like that, but we do have a music theory class and an AP music theory class, which a lot of students who have had some background with music and are really interested, they will take it and really enjoy it. We had last year, for the last couple of years, I want to say some musicians who are very enthusiastic about just, you know, their own careers in music. And we had actually a lunch club, a music lunch club, where they would jam with each other. I was on the Walnut Creek campus today, and one of our students was out in one of our group rooms, creating beats, is that what it's called nowadays? So there's a lot of musical students, and we try to support them as best we can. And you know, they formed this, the music club formed this music group where it was a mix of teachers and students just bringing their instruments on Fridays and just kind of playing music together. And they were fabulous, you know. We have a winter showcase, and you know, this student's jazz quartet played music for us, which was really awesome. So we try to support as best we can.
And just to add a little bit to this, we also have a lot of partnerships with arts education programs in the community, like East Bay Center for the Performing Arts, Berklee Jazz School, Stanford Jazz School. My background, I have a lot in arts education, so I've kept those connections. And obviously my daughter's a professional artist, so I've been involved since she was forever. But we also will really refer kids out. And the neat thing about that, if they take part in outside organizations, they can get elective credit for that. And we turn that into an independent study, which actually goes on either their middle school or their high school transcript. So they can really show what their interests are, what their passion is, what their talents are as they're transitioning either to high school or college or music conservatory. So we've had a lot of students that have been highly involved in different arts education programs that are doing this as part of the Tilden curriculum. It's not happening directly on campus, but it's integrated into their individual plan. And I'm kind of the person to go to for like, hey, there's this great thing over here, over here, over here. So also a reference for that at any time.
I see your question, Shelley. I'm gonna go ahead and repost what Rebecca shared so that you guys have it. Was there anything, Malcolm, that you wanted to add for our presentation tonight?
Hey, you know, we talked about mastery this evening, but, you know, also what constitutes mastery. And, you know, we try to meet students where they are, and we know they come with different interests and different learning styles. And so we've also very committed to, like, having students show mastery in the things that they enjoy doing. So we have project-based learning as well, where students can, if they're, you know, more visual, if they want to create presentations to demonstrate mastery, or, you know, really connecting with students very early on from the first class, you know, when teachers check in, you know, if a student is interested, say, cars, for instance, we have a student interested in cars. We can create lessons around that, you know, to get the student hooked and kind of hook into their interests. Because we find like when students buy into what we're doing, it's so much easier to kind of scaffold learning onto their interests. And there's so many opportunities for that. And some of what we're doing also within the humanities is we want to get students to be comfortable with technology, you know, and become responsible at technology use on campus. We find that, you know, nowadays it's more like the glut of information. It's not really access anymore. So we're really finding that we need to help our students learn technology, how to use technology. In English, for example, you know, Wikipedia is not the place to cite, you know, and you know, helping them sort of navigate this, because, you know, also during COVID, we've had students that were locked in with computers, and, you know, unlike a textbook, it's much more dynamic, your computer screen, you know, and so having to bring them back on. And we have study halls where it's like, you know, this is a space where you check in your phone, you have your book, you know, you can use technology, but we'll monitor it. And I don't think there's many spaces like that anymore where students are not distracted. And we want to offer that to them too on campus. And, you know, it's been quite effective, and we feel like there are lots of facets to support them, and we support them, you know, with their interests, you know. And I think the outcomes are good. And we're also, you know, when we're scaffolding their interests, you know, we're preparing them for careers that we don't know of yet. Sometimes there are things that they're going to be doing that we don't know. So we don't approach it with fear or being punitive, but like, how can you use this in a responsible way and get, you know, get your work done as well? So yeah, it's a work in progress, but we're always there, always working on it.
And just to add on that, the technology incorporation and how to use it responsibly, and then also acknowledging that for some of our kids, that's a big struggle, and there are issues with executive functioning that come with specific learning differences, et cetera. We do have other layers of support. The study hall, like Malcolm said, is a really proctored time where students are looking at what they need to prioritize, making a choice about what they're going to work on, or several things that they may work on during that 50-minute period with the proctor support to stay on task if they need it, or just to clarify what needs to happen. For some students, they need a level beyond that, and we have what's called study support. And that's really a one-on-one time where that student is working with a teacher in a subject area where they need more support on both really organizing the homework and completing the homework and or understanding. So it's both tutoring, but some of the executive functioning wrapped into that. And then above that, we have a new course that we're offering this year, which is executive functioning skill development, which looks at homework and again gets to what needs to happen, but really building those life skills, not just in homework, but organization around getting through the day, working one-on-one with a curriculum that we developed over the last year, really looking at research-based practices of what works well for the middle school to the high school to the early college transition ages as well. So there's different aspects that we offer for students that we know may need a little help with those organizational skills and prioritizing kind of the what, who, when, and why.
Yeah, I'm really glad that you brought that one up, Rebecca, because the executive function development course is really new, and it's it was developed in response to just actually listening to parents like yourself and really trying to get a better sense of how we can support our student population. And a big need is we get a lot of students that need the executive function support, as I think when I think back, we all do a little bit, especially at this age. So this is such a wonderful opportunity for these kids to get the one-to-one support on campus. And every teacher is trained on the fundamentals, and then a student can choose to take an actual class. But we support that system in every single class, every single day with our students. And it's really neat to see them kind of own those tools, own the study tools and approaches that they've developed with their teachers. It's pretty exciting. The other thing that came to mind that I wanted to talk about is also college acceptances. This is a question that we hear oftentimes here at the open house or during intake, is a lot of families want to know, how would a college view Tilden? And what I'd like to say is that Tilden is a college preparatory school and at its heart, and we of course work with every student to meet whatever they would like to do after their time at Tilden. But we do work with families very closely around the college planning and college acceptance cycle. And our college acceptances are actually really good. The percentages are, for students just planning to go to college for 4 years or for 2 years, we have about a 95% acceptance rate for that, where students are choosing to go. And in terms of a four-year college, it's, I think, 89% or so. A lot of that is working with families, working with college counselors, either internally, we might consult with a college counselor to kind of come up with a couple options for a student for four-year colleges that might be a good fit, or we would work very closely with you and maybe a private college counselor to find the right fit for your student and just support through the whole planning and application cycle. So I just wanted to mention that because that's often a question we get asked.
And I put the school profile from last year, so you can just get a sense of kind of who we are, who the students are. I believe on the school profile, there's also kind of past colleges or a range of colleges that our students go to. And it's really diverse from Ivy League to community college to trade school. It's very diverse.
Well, I see it's about 7:25. We can wrap it up and probably stay online if anybody wants to just hang around and ask us any questions. But it's really been such a pleasure talking with you all, answering your questions, and this is what we love to do. So feel free to reach out to us. Rebecca shared her contact information. Malcolm, do you want to put your contact in there just so folks can reach out to you at the Walnut Creek campus? but it really has been a pleasure. And I hope, I wish you all the luck in the world, just finding the right fit for your student. Oh, thank you.
And as Lori said, we'll just hang out a few minutes longer. So if you feel the need to get off now and have no more questions, thank you for coming. If you have any other questions you wanna just hang out and ask us now, we'll be here for the next 5 minutes or so. So feel free to use us.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Have a great evening.
Good night.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you mentioned someone mentioned a chess club.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I have a 13-year-old daughter who was in the chess club before and then stopped going to chess club because at her new school, it turned out to be only boys. Mm-hmm. Okay. And she was in chess club in third grade and she plays chess at home.
Okay. So,
are there any other girls in your chess club?
You know, please send me an email. I will follow up. We're starting these clubs up. Yeah,
please. And is the chess club only in Walnut Creek?
Right now, it's just at Walnut Creek. We're thinking there's a few kids that are interested in Albany. You should know the teacher that's facilitating it in Walnut Creek. We're still trying to identify, but we're hoping it's kind of a mixture of, you know, everybody who wants to come. We have a few kids at the Albany campus, both boys and girls who are interested. So we're kind of toying around. We just went out and got a bunch of board games downstairs just for breaks and during student lounge time. And for a lot of the middle school kids, that's kind of opened up like, okay, we're interested in this and this and that. So there's always possibilities. What we're really great at is helping make those connections with other kids and facilitating kids starting that club.
So it sounds like you're thinking about having like male and female mentors in the clubs, for the clubs. That's great.
We always think about that in terms of
the
students that are interested in terms of their role models and who they're looking to also be reflected in themselves or however they identify.
Okay, wonderful. Well, thank you. Thank you for your time.
Oh yeah, have a nice evening.
Have a good evening.
You too. Bye. Mm-hmm.
See a few more people on. I think I see Lori, other Lori, and Emily still on.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm really excited to hear about the clubs that you've got going, and I hope Dungeons and Dragons went well today.
Yeah, I think they're even doing it in the park. So.
Oh, they did it in the park. Oh.
Yeah, at 12 o'clock they went in the park for it.
Oh, cool.
And we're looking forward to the Robotics and Maker Club next week.
Yeah, that sounds awesome.
And leadership with also, I think it's leadership and social justice. Sort of a leadership club with some people that were also interested in the social justice club. So
mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's going to be a combination club. Yeah, that's going to be nice. And then Renee is leading the survival skills on Monday.
I am personally going to attend that one. That sounds awesome.
I think she's got a whole set of skills she wants to work on, and some of it's going to be out in the park too.
Cool. Wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yes. Well, it's 7:30, so I'm going to go ahead and log off. But thank you both for coming out here and everybody. It was really nice to spend the evening together. And I'll see you guys tomorrow.
See you guys tomorrow. Bye.
Great evening.
Have a nice one.